Did you say that this is the highlight of something?
It's the highlight of my week being in here. I'm not lying. Like, this is awesome.
Oh, cool.
This is really cool.
We're honored to have you.
Yeah, because I always walk by here and it's like, there's always so much fun happening. There's like balloons and, you know.
A lot of laughter.
Strippers and fun shit going
Confetti and glitter. Like, yeah. We were actually talking about that, about how much fun we have over here. And like, as you go that way in the building and shit just gets more and more serious until people are shitting diamonds.
Exactly.
You know what I mean? I mean, here people have diarrhea. It's just smooth and flowing.
We just walk by and look just...
Do you know Kara's been out for 2 days?
I heard that she has been ill.
Explosive.
Okay.
Really?
Yeah. Explosively ill? And she didn't really want to come on the show today, but I think she looks like...
I would not know.
She looks, Matt, that's for sure.
I mean, let's raise the bar a little bit. I ate a meal
this morning, so...
That's good.
It's going to be a good day.
I've been blocking my meals out.
Okay,
I've
good.
Never done that.
Nice. How's it going?
It's going well, actually.
How long?
It's week two.
You look lean.
Oh, man.
I'm trying. Well, I'm just trying to, you know, eat right, because I was eating the right stuff, but when we had that... thing with Leah, she, you know, I started figuring out what I eat for breakfast, and it was like, I mean, it was ridiculous. I have a huge breakfast. It was like 30 blocks or something. Like, oh dear.
You're a huge man.
I better not eat that much.
For those of you who don't know, Sean's saying he blocks out his meals, and what he's saying is that he uses the CrossFit prescription, which is the Zone Diet, which is the foundation of CrossFit. Mm-hmm. For those of you who don't know, it's actually diet before even movement.
Yeah.
And that diet keeps your hormones level and will keep you healthy. And that's why we work at a company that has the solution to the world's most vexing problem. Mm-hmm. While 70% of this country is going to die from chronic disease, Sean Woodland is working on making sure that doesn't happen.
Correct. I want to be one of the 30% that doesn't.
Still could die, as Greg would say, by a tire coming off a car and going through your windshield.
Tragic blimp accident. Yeah. You know, anything.
Yeah.
You know?
What kind of accident?
Blimp.
Blimp?
Yeah. It happened. It'd be a hell of a story.
Have you ever been in a blimp?
I've not.
Have you?
No.
Thank God. No, I'm not taking my chances.
For those of you who are listening on iTunes and aren't watching on YouTube, I don't give a fuck.
Oh, there it is.
What don't you give a fuck about?
Okay.
Oh, Eric, are you ready?
You need to wear that E like a badge of honor on iTunes.
You just said the S word.
You have a gentleman over who works in the games bullpen named Charlie Doobie.
Yes.
He is a gentleman of the highest order.
That is correct.
Every time I talk to him, I feel dirty because he feels so like kind of like holy. You know, he's just a
there is not one person in this building that dislikes Charlie. I've never met anybody who does not like that guy.
Very likable guy.
He's a great dude. I'm like, and I think that you were actually in the room the first time I ever kind of met him. It was via I think it was Google Chat or Skype or something. Remember, we were talking about the update show. Charlie had just sort of come on remotely, and then you popped in over my shoulder and started to talk to him. That was one of the first times I'd ever spoken to him. But he has been that guy does not get enough credit for what he does over in that area. I mean, he has done a whole lot to get us to where we are right now.
And he does it all with a smile on his face.
That is true.
Mm-hmm. I had this conversation with Rich Froning Jr. many years ago. Before he had like agents and sponsors and whatever. I think he just won his first games. And I said, the most amazing thing about you, Rich, is you're the kind of guy who could be seen coming out of a brothel and people would think you were saving women.
Yes.
That's like Charlie. No one, like any other man walks out of a brothel, like, oh, he's fucking hoes. And Charlie is that guy too. Yeah. His shit will not stick to this guy.
No, he's a great guy.
Yeah. You see him like carrying a straw and some meth, and you're like, oh, he must have taken that from some meth user.
There are days, especially when after the games and even during the games, where I'm stressed and he's stressed. You know, we're trying to put out those post shows and we have deadlines we got to hit. Yeah, but it's the way he handles it and the way that he has just he can sort of project this positive energy over everybody. It's a calming effect. When I need someone to sort of just put things in perspective for me, I just go in his office, we shut the door, we talk, and then we're fine.
I roomed with him for 4 years straight at the games.
What? At
the games. And every single night we would come back and decompress, and it was like the most relaxing part of my day.
Yeah. I think his hair has something to do with it too. He has kind of like that 70s fro. Mm-hmm. like what was the show that John Travolta was on?
Welcome Back Hotter.
Yeah, something like that. He's like one of those characters.
Yeah, exactly.
Are these mine? Where the fuck are mine? I haven't seen mine in 3 days.
Get the beep ready.
Oh, do you have a beep now?
We had it once.
I thought it was weapons hot here.
Yeah, that's.
I mean
that's actually our intro. It's just a beep. I,
these are the AirPods. By the way, if you don't own the AirPods, that is the greatest thing
what
Apple
is that?
Has made.
Oh yeah,
they're basically just plugs that go into your ear. And they're headphones.
Oh, okay.
Incredible.
And they're wireless and they sync up like perfectly with your iPhone every time and the case is a charger. I mean, it's like
but
Apple.
I, what's really nice is you're, say you're synced up to your desktop and you have them in, you take them out, the mutes, everything stops, you put them back into your ear, it starts again. Hmm. It's incredible.
They're smart.
Just because you can't hear them when they're out of your ear?
It could
be. How do you know it's muted?
You know, I'd rather just be in the dark on this and just go on praising them.
Got it.
Charlie is the producer of the update show.
Correct.
And did he produce the CBS shows this year?
That was sort of a team effort. So the way that the
I hate it when you guys do that shit over there, your team shit. Just give him the credit. Did he do it or not?
He did. Yes, he did two shows.
So team oriented over there.
He did two shows. So the way it worked, we had three teams of two people working on eight shows. Does that make sense?
Kara, do the math. Tell me what Sean said after the show, please. Okay, yes.
So
24 kids.
Charlie and Mark Billingsby did episodes 3 and 4 of the men's shows. Irvin Anfoso and I did episodes 1 and 2.
What's Irvin's last name?
Anfoso.
I've said it wrong forever. Go on.
Most people do. And then Alan Brum and Tim Rowell, who help us out during the games, handled all 4 of the women's shows.
Okay.
So that's how that worked. But we all had a hand in the – Charlie had a hand in the crafting of all the men's shows. He and I worked pretty closely on all that. But we both sort of worked separately on putting the two shows together. We would talk, hey, this is what we're doing. Okay, how are we going to make that match up with what you're doing? And then we would kind of go our separate ways and try to make that mesh together.
He didn't have some overarching position over all the shows?
Not necessarily. Like that's more of a Joe thing.
Okay. I feel like I was in some meetings with him and Joe early on. And Joe is like, Charlie, you got this. But I'm only listening 50%. The other 50%, I'm trying to come up with shit to say, funny shit to say.
Yep. That's him. Yep. So that's Charlie. That's Joe Novello, who is the coordinating producer of the CrossFit Games.
He's the big dog.
And then that's Mike Roth, who is our lead television director for the CrossFit Games, and he does some regionals, did the Invitational as well. He is also the full-time television director for the Carolina Hurricanes of the National Hockey League. He has a lot of experience.
Hey, he's the man.
Yeah.
I've spent some time in the truck with him. He's great.
Yeah.
Calm.
CrossFitter.
Charlie watched at least one podcast. No, that's not that. That really?
Yeah.
He's a fan?
Yeah, he is.
Okay.
Can't stop talking about it.
And he gave me some advice that was like just, you know, like, hey, actually, I wouldn't even say his advice. He goes, hey, some feedback I have for you is, you know, your glasses, like, they're not clear. And, you know, you might want to try some clear glasses.
He did not say that.
Yeah, he did.
Did he really?
Yeah, that was his, like, that was his advice.
But this is more like active listening, like, hey, great job, but here, I understand this.
Yeah, it was a shit sandwich.
I thought it was just the look you were going for with the dirty glasses.
They're not dirty.
Oh, I thought that's how they were.
Yeah, that's how they are. But why?
The reflection.
Yeah, that is the look I'm going for. But you don't mean dirty like isn't like I don't clean them.
Not dirty isn't filthy. Just like you know, a hipster's not trying to be dirty. That's just like the way they
are.
That's
how they are. They're just hipsters.
Matt,
talk to me.
No.
Cut.
Then Tommy Marquez was on the show and he had a vomitous amount of advices.
Really?
And by that I mean in a lot. And I'm wondering, do you have any advice?
For you?
Yeah.
No, I don't. I think from what I've seen with you guys, I think you do a really good job of keeping it conversational. And I mean, I didn't even know we were recording something right now. I would just feel like we're sitting around BSing like we always do. And that's hard to do. I think the hardest thing for people to do when they're either being interviewed or on camera or, you know, just sitting down doing an interview for print is to be themselves. You can act like yourself, but it's hard to be yourself. And I feel that watching you guys, this is who you really are. I don't think you're trying to pull any punches here. That's hard to do.
It's kind of like that.
That's my Instagram page.
You're faking it until you make it. You're faking it until you make it. Be yourself, be yourself. And all of a sudden you're like,
it's hard.
Oh shit, the show's over.
Yeah.
Oh shit, I think I was myself for a second.
Right. It's tough because the second you put a microphone in someone's face, they feel like now all of a sudden I have to sound really smart and I have to talk for a long time and all my points need to go on and on and on. And that's not the case because that's not how you would be in a regular conversation. But for some reason, when the light goes on and the microphone gets put on your face, people just think that's how it's supposed to be.
How long did it take you to get over that?
I'm still working on it. No, I had.
You do work on it every show?
I think for sure. I think preparation and being comfortable in the setting is the biggest thing. So if you throw someone in a setting where they're uncomfortable, regardless of how skilled they are, they're not going to be able to be themselves and really present all the information that they have in a way that, you know, makes it natural for people to listen to. But if you're comfortable, that's step number one. then it's just a matter of preparing and understanding, making sure that you can present whatever you're going to present in an understandable manner, in a quick, concise way.
It's like dancing. I'm so uncomfortable dancing.
Yeah.
But sometimes if you get into a rhythm, it's yeah. okay.
No, I've never been.
How many times have you gone out?
I've never, not that many.
I feel like at a wedding, if I go out there early and dance, I've got a better trajectory for good dancing at the wedding.
Because you feel like you're setting the pace.
Yeah, and you're kind of like, oh, that guy's a dancer, he's there. But if you skip the first couple of dances, you're like, you don't hit the mark and you suck all night.
Do you dance?
Not well.
But you do dance?
I get out there.
Do you dance?
I mean, I like to.
Do you dance,
Eric? I don't think I'm good until I have a couple drinks.
And you will?
It depends what kind of music's playing.
Eric only dances to mariachi music.
I mean, it has to be dark.
Yeah.
In the room. Yeah, it has
to be really
dark.
I'd prefer people to not look at me while it's happening, but it's pretty fun.
I just think that I'm to the age now where if I get out there and do that, people think, what is he doing? It's hard for me now to fit into that crowd and not look like I'm trying too hard. You know?
Right.
I don't want to be that guy.
Yeah, I'm definitely trying too hard. Kara, when you were homesick the last 2 days, did you have anyone visit you?
No.
What?
It sounded so disappointed.
Are you married, Sean?
I am.
Zero people.
So, Kara was at home the last 2 days. She was
on my deathbed.
Yeah, she was violently ill. Mm-hmm. Did you vomit?
Yes.
Okay, so both ends were.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
If we're going to be
no, it's TMI okay. here. It happens. Yeah, sure. That's not TMI. That's no just thing. Being sick, you know?
Being in a relationship, your wife is sick like that, or do you stay close to her and comfort her? Or do you give her space? Are you the kind of, she's puking in the bathroom, do you go put your hand on her forehead and like?
I would try to do that. Mm-hmm. That's definitely my first instinct. But I think you understand, and you probably know this too, you have to take the temperature of the situation. Sometimes you just got to back off and not be in the way, because anything you do is going to be wrong and you're just going to make the situation worse.
Right.
Familiar with that.
So you're just, yeah, exactly. You just, I'm here for whatever you need. You know, then you try to be supportive, and then if you get waved off, I'm backing off.
Right.
You know, because I think men are always, we always just want to fix things.
Right.
Sometimes you can't fix it.
Right.
Sometimes you can't. You just got to listen and be like, yeah, I'm sorry that I'm here for you. And
it's not about the nail.
It's not about the nail. Have you seen that video?
No.
If anyone is out there, go to YouTube and go and search It's Not About the Nail.
Oh.
Was this Sean advice
it's like a, it's
to
like a
Matt?
Minute long video.
Did you give him this advice?
I kind of, yeah, I did. Okay. And it's fantastic.
I'm just wondering
really
how you guys both knew.
Help men deal with unwinnable situations.
Let me ask you this. When she's in the bathroom, when you guys are in the bathroom, you're married.
Mm-hmm.
Do you shut the door when you go to the bathroom?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, you do?
Absolutely.
And if she needed toilet paper, do you just put your hand in and throw it
Yeah,
in?
It would be like a reach and a toss. It is.
Okay,
you know?
Okay.
Yeah.
The assist.
Exactly.
Do you shut Stephen the door Curry. At your house?
Yeah, I shut the door. We only have one bathroom, so it's pretty cozy.
And when you throw in the toilet paper, do you...
We keep the toilet paper underneath the sink, so it's always a stash.
It's always...
Preemptive.
Okay. I never close the door.
Really?
I never close the door.
Well, you've also got three children running around.
But I've never closed the door.
Why?
Okay.
I just wide open or
I gave
just
you
a crack?
Out there. I couldn't use it.
No, like I just.
Is it more like, for like look what door? I have created type thing?
I'm just not a door closer. We just don't.
Oh yeah. No, I close the door. There's police tape and the whole. I don't.
It's your time.
Just don't come in here.
Crime, stay out.
What? Will your snatch be for the liftoff? What will your max snatch be?
Right now, if I hit 185, I'd be extremely happy.
Will you hit it? Are you just saying
I
that?
I think I could. I think I could. I haven't.
Shoulder surgery.
So, yeah, I had, for those of you who don't know, I had shoulder surgery on a torn rotator cuff, and then I had a partially torn bicep, so they had to cut my tendon and reattach it. I've been healthy now for about 2 months. But
why did that happen?
I think it was wear and tear over a long, long time. I mean, I can remember even before I started CrossFit, having problems with my left shoulder. I think it stemmed from football, and then I heard it playing hockey like 25 years ago pretty badly.
Two very abusive sports.
Yeah, and then just never really rehabbed it correctly, and then probably from years of just moving poorly, you know, in presses and bench presses and things like that, just sort of exacerbated the situation. And then, yeah, so that was like me the first time I got to put a PVC pipe overhead.
Is that looks pretty good.
Is that's active shoulder, Kara?
Not at that point.
You could twist those armpits a little
bit. Yeah, I could
bit
twist
more.
Them a little bit. I was just happy to have something over my head. But it was.
Yeah, how far? That's 2 months.
So, yeah, so you know, you've been through it. You know, it's just one of those things where you the first time you put a PVC pipe over your head, you're like, okay, Thank goodness. I remember the first time I took my sling off, I was like, I am never going to move my arm again.
Right.
I mean, I had nothing. I couldn't, I could barely move it. But anyway, so my strength is not back to where it could be, but if I think I could do, I think I could hit 185.
You're not just saying that because you're on the air and you feel.
No, I think I could do it. Yeah. I did it like three times in the open. Yeah, that was the open
there
last year.
There you go.
Oh, nice.
Yeah. Yeah, you did. That was
awesome. I almost never snatch. I don't enjoy the lift. I just never do it.
I like it, but it's just I'm bad at it. Like I have because when I started CrossFit in 2007. There were no real good like CrossFit coaches. There were no weightlifting coaches. And so you just kind of tried to figure stuff out yourself. You'd go online and you'd watch Bergener's videos and you'd say, okay, I'm going to try that. But I know over the years I've developed just a lot of bad habits and I'm probably not as strong as I should be because of it. And we had Coach Bergener here the past couple of days for the lift off and just talking to him, I need someone like that just to take me and say, okay, you've never seen a barbell before this and just start from zero and work my way up. Right. Because I know that there are things I do wrong. I just don't know how to clean it up.
Well, I entered yesterday and I did the snatch.
Really?
And I loved it. I got 135.
Nice.
I failed 145 twice. I had never, ever in my life pulled under a bar and failed. It was always like I got scared down here on the pool. And I actually pulled under one that I couldn't stand up with and I was like really proud of myself. That was like a fear overcame. Yeah, so I did 135. I think my max ever is 147, probably like 5 or 6 years ago. Are you going to do it?
I mean, since I've been sick, I guess.
Why not?
I probably will, but I'm not going to expect too much out of myself.
Since I've been sick, I probably will.
I probably will. I just won't expect a lot.
Right
now. Although going on the scale will be great.
I
what you
different
think,
weight
you,
class.
Right, how much you think you lost?
I don't know. I'm just joking.
You look thin.
My mom always says that every time she sees me. I could be 280 pounds. You look thin. Are you eating?
Oh. Well, I'm not her mom.
Yeah.
So you will enter.
I'll probably do it.
Okay. I mean, the reason why I bring it up is one is because I want to promote it. I want to talk about it on the show. I think it's a cool thing. But like, I really, really am so happy that I entered because like, I would not have done that snatch yesterday.
See, and that's
and
the
I did
thing.
Not
I think...
like that lift. And I did it. And I was like so proud of myself yesterday. I mean, it's not even like a lift. Jesus. It's not even a lift. I am, it's not something I enjoy, but I walked with a little swagger yesterday while she was in the toilet. I was swaggering around.
I think for me, the reason why I don't do things like this is I hate to lose. Like I hate losing more than I like winning. And so if I do a lift where I hit, if I walk away feeling like I could have done more and then I fail, it's like it's almost worth not – I don't want to try because I don't want to fail.
Right.
And so that's what holds me back. But when I have done it, be like, hey, you know what? Let's just do it. It's always a good feeling knowing that you were able to max out. You do it, and maybe you didn't hit what you hit, but at least you got out there and you did it. And you might surprise yourself.
Right.
So, I think I'm going to give it a whirl.
That noise you guys are hearing is the professional broadcaster, Sean Woodland, banging on the table like a jackass.
I will not do that anymore.
No, you can.
Okay, I can't.
Just wanted to call you some names.
All right, I appreciate it. I feel like I'm in the club now.
I wanted to talk to you about some of the feedback Tommy gave me. Swearing. He said there's never been swearing on the update show.
Not while I've been there, but I know there has been.
In the past. And yesterday, we during the liftoff announcement, Mike Bergener used potty language, foul language.
I think he
language.
Did have he some did. That slipped out over the air.
Yes.
There it is.
Hey, he said...
He said the brown word.
Yes, yes.
I think so, yeah.
Yeah, yeah, thank you.
There we go.
Forgive me, we get it. Is that, do you guys flinch? Do you guys get all weirded out? Or is it just like nothing? It's not that strict. I mean, Tommy made it seem like it was so strict, like you guys were virgins.
I don't know if it, this is the way I feel about it. This is just my feelings. I think in our setting, what we're trying to accomplish, I think if you use, you know, if you resort to profanity, it sort of undermines your credibility. There's better ways to do it. And I just think it comes off as unprofessional. That's just my personal opinion. There's times for it. I mean, I cuss like a sailor, but when I'm on air.
Oh, you do cuss like
a
sailor
outside,
off air?
I mean, outside, sure. Off air, yeah, I swear all the time. But I'm
so you're not yourself on camera.
Not that way. No, I'm not going to
walk right into
just
that.
Yeah, exactly. I just don't think that that's the setting for it. I think that more often than not, that type of thing will undermine your credibility more than it will help it.
I think it's a good practice and discipline.
Yeah.
I'm impressed that you can do it.
Oh, it's hard.
Did you have to practice off air, just like in regular? I mean, now you're comfortable, I think,
no, I
in
think
the
that,
different settings. But
yeah, I think for the most part, because early in my career, it was always a teleprompter. So you just read everything. Right. So there's no, you know, you're not going to type in, you know, the F word and read that on air.
What's the best replacement for a swear word that you've used on air?
The best replacement?
Yeah.
Ah, man.
Is that how you do it?
Like, took like
Matt suggesting? Yeah, yeah.
Like, give me an example. Like, if I would say, you know, if I were going to say, holy, that was a great lift. Uh-huh. I'd probably say, I don't know. That's a good question.
You have some great
holy
lines.
Holy shenanigans.
You have some great lines. Do you practice those ahead of time? You're like, okay, 2008 CrossFit Games, 18 CrossFit Games. You have like a notebook full of like.
Are you talking about like when it's the final thing?
Yeah.
So basically the way it works, the night before, every Saturday night after the competition is over, I usually go back to the hotel. I look at the leaderboard and I figure out, okay, who can win this thing? Mm. And then I try to come up with a couple calls, like things that I should say when it's all said and done. You know, what would a good call be? And it's worked out pretty well with the men. I had one for the women that I really wanted to use, and I actually start it when Tia Toomey is at the coming to the finish line, then she drops it and just blew the whole thing up. I wasn't able to use it. And then the past couple of years, the way it's been with the women, how we haven't known until the final announcement, there really has not been that big moment.
What is the one you were going to use?
The one I was going to
here. Use it.
I was going to say. She comes from the land down under, but right now she's on top of the world. Tia Toomey is the fittest woman on earth.
That's good.
If you go back and watch that final heat, which, by the way, was the most exciting thing I have ever called in my life. Yeah. Tanya and I were probably this closer than this, and we were yelling. And
were you standing?
Oh, yeah.
Did you stand up?
Yeah. Yeah, and I could not. I usually do stand when I do it, but we could not hear each. If it hadn't been for a headset, I would not have been able to hear. That place was going berserk. Yeah. It was so fun.
It was the first time at the CrossFit Games I thought, oh, the crowd is damaging my ears.
Yes.
I said, I need to put something in my ears.
Oh, man.
It was that loud.
So
sound
loud
had feeling in that place.
Yes.
Like you could, that was incredible.
Madison did not let down.
No, you know what? And I'll be really honest with you. When we were there for the open announcement, I went to the Alliant Energy Center. And now, granted, there was nothing there. It was still just a big, giant, empty convention center. And I was with Joe Novello, who is our coordinating producer. And I was with, I can't remember who else, a couple other people from the broadcast team, probably Mike Roth. And I looked at what was out there. I go, I don't know how we're going to make this work. I go, I don't know how this is going to happen. But I have seen what our team has been able to do in other places, and I just took faith.
What was the big obstacle? So you're like, oh my God.
It was just didn't look good. There was nothing there.
It was like a tired casino.
Yeah, where we had the...
Like a North Shore.
Tahoe.
Or even South Shore nowadays. You know what I mean? You're like, damn, that shit is tired.
Where you had the obstacle course... there was nothing there. It was a parking lot. You could drive through that whole thing. And then the arena, it's just an old building. It's an older building that I think they house a minor league hockey team there. Mm-hmm. And you would walk in and the seats looked like they were out of the 60s.
Right.
And we all admitted this place needs a facelift. And I give a ton of credit to the team that worked, the event team that put that place together, because it looked fantastic. You could not tell.
Great.
Yeah. I was blown away.
I don't like to do this in 27 episodes. I probably haven't done this, but I got to give Dave Castro a shitload of credit for having the vision to do that.
Oh, absolutely.
I mean, I'm pretty close to him, and I didn't want to be like, hey, dude, you're fucked this year.
I said to my wife, I was like, I don't know how we're going to do this. I really don't know how they're going to do it.
And it came off amazing.
It was fantastic. Yeah. It was a great time.
It really was.
So you'll practice the lines. You'll have them
final calls.
Like, Ben Smith couldn't run any faster if his pants were on fire.
I won't do like, that. No,
I'll never forget the Rich Roning of 2015.
Is that the 4-time one?
Yeah.
Yeah, I wrote that one out.
I remember talking to you about that before.
Yeah. Yeah, and I'll run them by Bischel and Haynes sometimes too.
Oh yeah.
One of my favorite positions. Yeah, that's right.
Yeah,
you should try it sometimes.
I will. If I see you, I'll run them by you too.
Yeah. Next time you run around doing behind the scenes, I'll be like, hey, you know what, Savon, if you go over here, probably a better vantage point.
Because I'll tell you why, because he's the only guy who took an active interest in it. He would come up to me and be like, hey, man, you got some calls, what do you got?
And be
like,
okay, here's what I'm going to do.
And so then I just started bouncing ideas off him and Haynes. That's kind of how it worked. Like, they were the only two guys who were...
Oh, and what's Haynes' response? Haynes has like two facial expressions.
He's got words.
Well, that's the thing. If I get a reaction out of Haynes, then I know I've done something right.
If you get a, oh.
But how, okay, my question is, when he presented it to you, was it as intense as it was when it was live?
If I remember correctly, I think you were kicking around either two or three different ideas, but like the crescendo buildup one was by far the best.
Yeah.
Oh, man, that was just...
If I remember correctly.
The timing of that was so amazing.
I got pretty lucky on that one. Like that, it was just, it was the perfect situation, the perfect right. event. He was out front the time. Like it was just, it like could,
a couple more
it just
reps.
Everything came together. And yeah.
Sean Woodland has worked at CrossFit Inc. for
full time since January 2013, and then part time since May of 2012.
And he has always been involved very heavily on the games production.
Yes.
Mostly it was his voice and his face. And in the last year or two, it's gone beyond that to producing.
It's always been a little bit producing. So we've always tweaked how we do the post shows. We're kind of looking for that perfect formula because when we come.
Thanks for coming to me with questions and asking me for advice.
Yeah. And you know what? Honestly, that's probably going to be the next thing because where we'd like to go with it. And
No. Just keep going to Matt.
Ooh, you got a diamond in the rough over here.
What we're trying to do with the post shows is that we want to give the people who watched it live a different experience. Because if we just repackage, like in the old days when we used to do them, we honestly used to just recut whole events and just show them.
Right.
Well, what's people who watch it live, what is that giving them that's different? We would maybe throw an athlete feature in there or something. So now we're trying to go more of the model of like an HBO Hard Knocks or Season on the Brink that Amazon does, that more sort of documentary style that tells a story but also includes action. And I think we're getting closer to that formula. And the past couple of years, I've been lucky enough to get involved with more of the sort of the writing of the episodes and laying them out and figuring out what the major storylines are. Because you can't, you know, in an hour episode, you can't focus on all 40 athletes. You kind of have to pick your battles. And you guys know that with the documentary you make. You can't have, you know, 80 athletes that you're talking about all the time.
Are there rules on how you present yourself? Like, does someone tell you you have to shave your head and your face?
No.
You could show up with a big old handlebar mustache.
I probably could. I wouldn't, but
it's interesting. When we were with ESPN, there were some really strict rules. I remember the first year we went on ESPN, mm-hmm. they basically wanted it to look like a sport. And that's not my background at all. My background is to tell the story.
Sure.
And to really get into the character development. And last year there was some tremendous progress made on that, even though I think we were on ESPN. There was still some tremendous
progress. Last year we were on CBS Sports Network.
Sorry, 2 years.
2 years ago.
Two years ago, yeah. Sorry. Last year and this year seemed like the same thing to me. I apologize. 2 years ago, we had started really integrating more and more footage. And so for people who don't know, we have a broadcast team, and then we have the documentary team, and then I do the behind the scenes.
Right.
And so the broadcast team last year we were on ESPN actually started incorporating the most footage it ever had from the behind the scenes mm-hmm. and from the documentary crew footage that they had, which, you know, was great. I thought it was amazing. And then this last year on CBS, it was even more so. And I think it goes to the sophistication of our audience and of people who watch sports mm-hmm. and to just the way the world's going. It's kind of like, do you remember the old Supermans with Christopher Reeves?
Yeah.
They were like comedies.
Yeah.
And now superhero movies are not comedies.
No, they're more, there's more depth.
Yeah.
And they're so much better.
Yeah, I agree. Much better. So like this last thing that this last Wolverine thing they did, Logan.
Oh, it was amazing.
I mean, this fantastic. Shit is, the character great development movie. Is out of control.
Because what I love about it, and now we're going to go off into.
By the way, I'm having trouble hearing Sean's mic.
What I love about him is that in the old days, like you mentioned the Christopher Reeve Superman.
Right.
They were these perfect characters with no flaws who just represented the ultimate good. Now you're getting heroes that have gray areas, and I think that's so much more interesting.
Right.
It's great, but that's just my
right. It's 100% true. Yeah. Same with the Harry Potter. Like the darker it got, mm-hmm. you know, it's like I liked it.
Yeah, for sure. That's why Empire Strikes Back is the best Star Wars movie.
It was more right. Yeah. Right. Empire you mean because at the end, what happens to Mr.
It's just
Solo?
A darker movie.
Yeah. You're like, oh man. As you were, Kara, what were you going to say?
I don't think
you
I
talk
was...
about beaches. You're going to give us some. Beaches. You're going to give us some.
My mind's off.
Side. Because of this show, I've been receiving a shitload of direct messages, probably like anywhere between 5 and 10 a day. And all of them are positive. No one actually ever said anything negative. They save all the negative shit for YouTube.
Yeah, that's, and don't read YouTube comments. I learned that really early on.
Stinging pile of vitriol.
Yeah, it's just awful.
And I made my first comment response on YouTube ever.
It's a mistake.
Yesterday, someone said something, you really shouldn't say X, Y, and Z. And I just wrote back, go fuck yourself. And then afterwards, I woke up in the morning and being like, ah, damn it, I should have stayed.
That's the problem. Never punch down, because if you do, you're going to get hooked. It's like, don't get hooked.
Okay.
Don't punch down and don't get hooked, because the second, you're probably going to type something that you regret, and it's not going to turn out well.
Then you're going to think about it more.
You have to go into that and treat it like an email, where you draft it, and you're like, okay, I'm going to wait an hour to send that.
Yeah.
All right.
And then the hour, like, that was dumb.
I mean, I had a bottle or two of wine.
Yeah.
And I always respond to all the direct messages, every single one. And I said that yesterday on the show or 2 days ago on the show, and then someone responded right away with like, hey, you didn't respond to mine. Well, that's because I have this group of direct messages. The list is now 12 of stuff like I want to like craft a better response than just like thank you or go fuck yourself. Like I want to give them something.
Something thoughtful.
Yeah. How do you handle that? How do you handle the direct messages in your social media? People,
it depends what the content is. If it's someone who I feel like is being genuine and, you know, isn't trying to be a jerk. If someone just writes a comment and is just totally negative, I usually just delete it.
Do people send you negative direct messages?
I have never gotten a negative direct message.
Yeah,
I've gotten
weird.
Some negative comments on some things. Right. I just delete them and block them. But when people, I try to respond, because I treat it as like, if I wrote to somebody and had a legitimate question, I would be happy if they wrote me back. So when people write me, whether it's on Facebook or on Instagram, and sometimes I don't get to all my Instagram messages because like they have like message requests and I don't see them
until separate
like
inbox.
4 right. weeks later. I hate that and I feel really bad. But when people get a hold of me on Facebook, which is the best way to get a hold of me on social media.
I still can't hear Sean, just so you know, through my headphones. I don't know if it matters, but
I'm not saying anything meaningful. when they message me, I'll write them back and I try to be nice. And as long as it's like a legit question, they're not trying to be jerks. We get requests sometimes for the Update Show crew to do like special videos for people. And we've done that a couple times. If it's an easy thing to do. Some guy was...
Oh, you shouldn't have said that. It depends,
it depends what it is. Some guy wanted something really fast for his buddy who was getting married. We had time. We did it. And you know, I hope that made their day. That makes me feel good when we're able to do stuff like that.
Well, you are bordering on verification territory, so
they might start coming in more.
Uh-oh.
I doubt that.
Yeah, probably not.
Dude, you're not even close to getting verified.
No, so I mean, Sherwood and McKernan territory right there. I'm just not, those guys are really good with it. Like, they post all the time.
I like your social media presence. I mean, you're openly a Rams fan. That says a lot.
That's
you're
right.
I want to, the weirdest thing happened last night. I want to try to find it and show it to you. A guy had direct messaged me.
And this happens regularly, right?
A guy had direct messaged me. So first I sent, we have a podcast text thread. And I said, hey, I'd like to have Sean Woodland on the show tomorrow. Do you think we can do that? And then at the same time, and Tyson's like, yeah, sure, I'll hit him up. Damn it, where is this guy's name? And at the same time, I was direct messaging with a guy. Oh, here it is. 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 This is really, really long. He said, he's direct messaging me, and he's basically saying, hey, I work out at, I'm a nobody in the CrossFit world. I work out at a gym in Sacramento, California. I'm gay. The reason why I do CrossFit is one of the reasons is like, I want to be able to, as strange as it sounds, I want to be able to prove that I can do stuff. Mm-hmm. As well or better than straight men, and just it was like just an intimate exchange. I'm not doing it justice. I'm kind of taking it out of context, but that kind of stuck with me. And we're talking back and forth, and I'm thinking like, oh, this would be cool to have this guy on the show. And I'm sharing it with the rest of the podcast team, and they're sending me pictures from his Instagram that he works at McDonald's. I thought that was cool too. Like, I've never talked to anyone.
I know where you're going with this.
I know. You know who it is?
There's a funny story behind that too.
So it's going back and forth. I'm like, oh, I've never, like, I worked at McDonald's for a day. And other than that, I've never known anyone who worked at McDonald's.
You mean like go at a restaurant?
Oh, did you?
Yeah, for one day.
Okay.
I got the job. I got that. Oh, that's another story. So
you have to show it to me when we're done. And I'll...
Okay. Well, so this guy knows you.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I know who you're talking about. And I think that.
And I'm tripping. Yeah. What I'm tripping on is that. Like literally 30 seconds, like I'm texting with him and then I'm asking Tyson if you can be on the show. And then he says to me, I asked him, how did you get into CrossFit? And somehow your name comes up. Mm-hmm. I want to,
all stars aligned.
this is where it starts to get fun. I was working for an advertising agency, and our client was a bunch of crotchety old rich white dudes who hated everyone except for some reason they got along great with me. My boss always said, Caleb, you remind me so much of Sean, because he was the only other person who would get through to the clients.
That guy has my old job before I started working here.
Oh, really?
Oh, no kidding.
Yeah. So before I came here, so I had I'll give the short story, but I was in television for about 11 years.
Okay.
Got out of it, got into PR and marketing.
Okay.
Moved back home to California, back to Sacramento, and worked for an advertising agency based out of there. And their only client was McDonald's. So I have seen that side of the business, and it was like I was resigned to the fact that I was done with broadcasting, that I now had this career that I was going to use to, you know, move up and you know, work my way up the corporate ladder. And he now has my old job.
Oh, so funny. He doesn't work at McDonald's.
He works for the ad agency that.
That's what I was confused about, because it looked he was like working at booths and stuff, or at least you're just looking on his Instagram.
Yeah, that's exactly the same stuff I used to do.
Did you know him?
I did not know him when I worked there. No, he got there long after I had left.
And so you were never like CrossFit bros. You never worked Wow.
No, but I've spoken to him. He's a great guy.
Yeah. Okay. Cool. So you think maybe we should have him on?
Sure.
You got him into CrossFit.
Yeah.
Good job.
You know, hey, if I can reach one person. You know.
Oh, that is right. Yeah, you did get him into CrossFit. He basically got into CrossFit because I guess your boss said Sean was into CrossFit, and you're just like him, so you should get into CrossFit. He's got a pretty cool Instagram.
Yeah.
He hangs out with a lot of like good looking people.
Mm-hmm. He's a good dude.
All right, cool.
What box does he go to?
I think it's Loco Ocho. Yeah.
Loco Ocho.
Is he Mexican?
I don't think so.
Is he Portuguese?
I don't know.
Brazilian does he have Portuguese? An accent?
I don't think so. No, he doesn't.
So he sounds like he's born in this country?
Yeah, as far as I know, yeah.
Because for some reason, when I read his DMs, I'm saying it like I read him to myself like he's a foreigner.
Okay.
I don't know why. You know, like sometimes you just do that. Yeah,
you just assign someone a voice.
I think that's a good introduction for our podcast audience of who Sean Woodland is.
Yeah, man. Now that, you know, direct message me whenever you want. I'll try to respond. Just don't be a jerk. That's my philosophy. Don't be a jerk, and I'll respond to you.
I've got a birthday coming up.
Do you really think he's a chance of getting verified soon?
No, I'm not.
Dude, I mean, that is.
That's so.
What are the
not,
rules for checks getting
checks in the
verified?
Mail? You know how fast these things work.
Have you asked Matt to get you verified?
No, I don't even know.
Hey, you DM me. We can get it working.
If someone needs, like, honestly, if I need to get verified, that's
why would he get verified so quickly? Because he's on TV.
I don't.
Yeah. I mean, you either you're a host of something, like a let's just say arbitrarily, like a podcast maybe. Like you get verified a lot easier. I mean, really? it's not like a layup, but it's easier that way.
Why do I need that?
I don't know.
can you show Sean what like the blue check mark looks like?
Yeah, I've seen the blue check mark.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
I mean, just for reference though, Eric.
It's just so it means that you have arrived, Sean.
Is that what it is?
Yes. Okay. It means some 12-year-old who works arrived at Instagram gives you a thumbs up.
All right. Hey, feather in the cap. I'll take it.
It's the same blue that Tiffany uses.
It's a
Oh my god!
Look at that. You're verified. See, holy shit! You got 82,000 followers.
I had no idea I was verified.
Yeah.
Wow. I mean, that's how it happens.
You're verified.
I mean, is Josh Bridges verified?
Are you verified, Matt?
Yeah, no. Let's see if Josh Bridges is verified.
I mean, I would never be.
Let's
I bet
see.
He's verified. I know superstar Seth Rollins is verified. Dan Bailey's verified.
How could Josh Bridges not be verified?
Is he not verified?
Oh my goodness. Wow. Didn't see that coming.
520,000 followers. I just can't imagine that many people being interested in what I'm doing.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, he's verified.
Yeah, Dan
verified.
Is for sure.
So once you get verified, you get certain look at analytics of your site that your
is that
account.
True?
Yeah.
Or you
no, I'm serious. And so some of the analytics I've been looking at of where my followers come from, it's just bizarre. So like 78% of my followers are men. The biggest city is some city I've never heard of. It's a city in India.
Eastern India.
Really?
Yeah. It's
oh,
a
wow. It gives you
big
the stats.
Overseas.
Huh. Say that again. Oh yeah, maybe it's because all those followers
I made the
bought.
Same joke.
Did you make that same joke?
Oh yeah, instantly.
Will you click on that on that post? Hey Sevan, man, I love the podcast. This is what started the whole swearing discussion. By the way, some guy DM'd me asking about keeping the language down. I thought it was really nice.
I thought that's I read that one actually. Oh, I did. That's okay. Totally. I think, yeah, if that's how you're going to do it, that's a good way to do it.
Yeah, and then he sent a picture of his son actually watching the podcast from the back, and then I thought it was really nice of him, and I posted it, and it started kind of a shitstorm unintentionally.
Everybody's going to have an opinion about
that. Exactly.
What is something that someone says that's mean to you?
I'm trying to think.
What's the meanest thing?
The meanest thing? It's usually just about, I remember the funniest one. Well, this wasn't the meanest, but the funniest one was all it said, and just Sean the presenter is overweight.
Sean the presenter, yeah.
Sean the presenter is overweight.
And that was a YouTube comment.
That was a YouTube comment, yeah.
Go YouTube comments.
Have you ever been overweight?
Oh, yeah.
Can I see?
There's no pictures on my Instagram, but I could dig some up from high school.
No, I mean.
Oh, the comment. Yeah. I don't know where it is.
I
don't mean the comment, but like so.
On the show,
but you weren't overweight.
No, I don't think I was. No. I mean, I was 220. I mean, that's where I go between 215 and 220 usually. I was probably at 220 at that point.
Does your wife do CrossFit?
Yeah.
Has she ever told you you're chubby?
No.
Have you ever told her she's chubby?
Hell no.
Good job.
Yeah, exactly. My ass kicked.
On a final note, I'd like to say this. Great having you on the show.
Yeah, thanks love for having to have me. You this back. Is a blast. Anytime.
I appreciate you not lying.
Not lying.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't. I try not to. Friends don't lie.
Tommy told us that Joe Rogan has long intros to his show and always reads his...
like a rundown of what he's going to talk about?
No, sponsors. Has his sponsors on the show.
Oh, yeah?
And actually, so The only time I ever see Joe Rogan is on YouTube. Mm-hmm. So and I always just look at his sub clips. So the other day I went to the beginning of a couple of his shows and I didn't see any sponsorships or any introduction to his show. And so it must be
you're saying Tommy Marquez is a liar.
Misinformed.
Hey, side note actually. We got hit up. Somebody wanted to do an ad on the podcast and they asked for our rates.
Oh.
I laughed out loud.
Oh, funny. After tell the last one we were talking about. Anything. Yeah, I just saw an email.
But I just thought it was interesting. He doesn't do, from what I saw, Joe Rogan is crazy prolific. He has like 1,050 shows. I haven't looked at all of them. You know, I looked at two of them. And he did not talk about his sponsors. He did not have an intro. But I guess on Apple, on iTunes, and his other platforms, he does.
Yeah, interesting. Cool. I mean, typically they'll just kind of inject them, right?
In the middle?
Yeah, maybe it's just the podcast.
It must be
the
audio because the video definitely didn't have it that I watched.
Yeah.
So it's like.
Same with me.
They just
do you believe in UFOs?
On.
Do I believe in them?
Yeah.
I mean, I think people have seen things that they cannot identify, yes. So
I don't mean that. I mean, do you think there's
that they're of alien origin?
Yeah.
I'll tell you this. It really
follow-up was it.
I wish I wouldn't ask.
It really intrigues me. That's the one thing that I mean, I love all those specials and all those shows because I think I want it to be true because I think that would be fantastic. But I don't know. I just think it's really compelling. I don't know what to think.
Like I had these friends in college who did a shitload of acid and they always said that that cloud that's over Mount Shasta is a hiding spot for UFOs.
See, now that's,
and they really
that's
that.
A little too far, but there are, that I can't get on board with that, but there are some things that have happened that people legitimately can't explain, and it's, you know, I don't know what it is.
Did we do the whole show with the microphone pointed at his left nostril?
No, I think it's been like this.
No, he did.
Okay, good.
There you go. Yeah.
That was actually a pro move, having it on the inside.
Yeah, see, so that's why when I turn to address Matt, you can still see my face.
Ooh.
Pro tip right there.
Pro tip.
On that note, thanks, Sean.
Yeah, thank you. That was a blast.
That was great.
Thanks, Sean. Nice work.
Thank you.
Awesome. Thanks, brother.
Yeah, dude, that was a lot of fun.
Always is.
That's the highlight of my week right there.